Yes. Come on. I was funny because I was just asking him out there. I was like, are you just exhausted at talking about this movie? But are you exhausted at just getting all of these flowers that you so deserve? Or is it just more like, finally, about time?
Oh, wow. Thank you. First of all, I'm a little, I'm very moved today because not only just, I poked my head in to watch some of the film when I hadn't watched in a minute. So it's resonating in a different way. And then to have two people I deeply admire and who I consider my family here with me today. It feels like I'm getting a lot of flowers today. So yeah.
We love you.
We do. We love you. We love you. Well, first of all, congratulations on this. I know it's been a long journey to here. Making movies is a miracle.
Yes, it is.
So it's nice that we got to experience this miracle together. We both have seen the film. Yep. Loved it, talked about it. I was bugging you so much. I was like, I gotta see the movie.
Yes.
And for me, and hopefully, I don't know a lot of people, but there's a great documentary about him on PBS, which is where I think that's where my love affair began. I think for a lot of people, thank God for PBS telling us about heroes that sometimes get forgotten about in history books. But as I was thinking about this movie, it's so difficult to make stories like this something that people feel like is not just medicine, and to understand that it can be a cinematic triumph as well. But the other thing it makes me think about is historical figures such as Bayard that are so admired and beloved. It's difficult not to make them saints. So what I admire about it is you aren't afraid to lean into some of the flaws. Not just of his, but of the NAACP, you know, people that maybe sort of judged him because of who he was. But how was that for you to have to tap into some of his shortcomings, even though he is still a hero and someone that we obviously put on the pedestal, because why wouldn't we? But just wanted to kind of start there with you about this man, but also this human as well.
Thank you. Well, first, I read an early draft by Julian Brees. And it was actually a bit more personal, and it really dealt with the personal of Bayard Rustin. That was his way in, to really find all the stuff that you can't find in Wikipedia or documentary or something like that. And then there was another draft that they did that went far more into his organizing skills and the politicking of all of it. And then they struck a fine balance to have a little bit of both. And that's where I think it really starts to sing, where you can find all these, you need to have the whole personal, what's underneath this person, and all the mess, because he was a little messy in some of his relationships, right? Mm-hmm. But also I love the fact that those are part of what makes him so fascinating. He sort of led with not only his wit and intelligence, but also with his heart, with charm, with being attracted to things that may not even be right for him at that moment, going into these dangerous places and dark corners, because also that was the balance that my director, George C. Wolfe, please, yes.
Icon.
We talked about this a lot with the way he was laying it out, that, you know, men and women at that time, when they were trying to find love, lived in the darkness, lived in the corners. That's why the alleys at night and the dark spaces or going to find love, that there was always a sense of danger because that's where we lived. And then when he moved into the light, when he was moving into his fullness, that was also something. When he's going up the stairs of the Washington Mall, and when he's trying to be his full self, and you know, with all that light, that was a very, very conscious decision about the light and the dark, and where Bayard lived in those spaces. So I know it was important for me to try to craft a character that, even on the page, I thought there was so much there, but I know I wanted to really try to find the essence of his soul and find that spark, and find that thing that once I was when I researched and even talked to some of his comrades, they were like, oh, he led with the fire and the fuel and the potency. And I wanted you to see that light in his eyes. And then also see when that danger would flicker around him. And when he was sort of like, you know, go inward. And I thought that there was for me, it was like a loss of the light in the world when it went out of his eyes or his soul. And also even like, you know, constructing even around his physicality and his voice. Because his voice, if you listen to any of his any audio or interviews and things like that, he had a very high-pitched voice and was kind of reedy. And then he spoke with the mid-Atlantic standard accent of his own making. When you start to research and you find out about that about someone, you're like, that's a fascinating human being. You're like, why would somebody do that? He's already black and queer and from Westchester and a Quaker. And he's doubling down. He said, you know what? Let me give myself an accent. It's kind of cool. So, but I found that he gave himself, he started to lean into a bit of an accent because he had a stutter. So it was helping him sort of like hang on to language. And I understood that because I grew up with a slight lisp. And then I took speech classes. And so I think it made me, you know, relish language and, you know, chew on words. And so I thought that was such a fascinating part of character. And then how to use that as a tool for a film, which is to sort of like when he's in rooms, when he's trying to take over the room, it has a bit more of a flourish like he did. His accent came and went in different interviews. Sometimes it was a bit more like Katharine Hepburn. There are times that it was highly, you know, RP. And you're like, what is happening? But we would make decisions to use it in a scene and use it to great effect. And there were times when it would just completely fall apart when he was being a bit more vulnerable. So for me, that was to find all that tricky weirdness and flawed spaces within him. And then also to really, I don't know, I really want to find how he moved in spaces and what was different for him, which was like when he was in rooms with the NAACP and how his body, he's trying to conform and be like the other dudes. And even the cut of his suit, we wanted to make sure that it was maybe a little, it didn't fit as well. He didn't feel as free. And so that's why he would show up in rooms and feel like a smaller person than when he was in other spaces when with his young people, and he would fling his arms wide open and take up more space. So we're just trying to find that not only in body and voice and pitch, but also in like all this, the different spaces that this, you know, a queer person had to navigate in those spaces to protect their bodies, you know, to be defiant, you know, and really just in how they use, how he uses wit, his incredible wit.
You speak of essence and light and dark and the spark around him. And it makes me, and fire you spoke of as well. And it makes me think of this question, which is not necessarily about your creation of him, your embodiment of him, but what you would, the colors you would pick and the essences you would pick if you were to create an image of him for us to look at. What would you do? What would you pick? What would you decide were the things that make him, or the makeup of him?
That's beautiful. And it's funny because I did make a decision about that.
I thought you
that
might.
That he, the color blue and all the hues of blue made sense to me. That because he was living in this, I mean, maybe it's one of the images that always stands out to me when I view the film is when he's walking up the stairs of the Lincoln Memorial. And that beautiful, beautiful blue that seems infinite with possibility, that's divine. Because he was a very spiritual man. You know, comes from a raised Quaker, but he believed, you know, he studied teachings of Gandhi. He was always, you know, curious about people and the world. And so for me, it's like that pale, beautiful, ethereal blue. And then there's the royal blues, you know, where he's trying to, you know, really feel like his own king in many ways. And it's a very defiant color, I think. And I think that there's, you know, blues have, you know, blue in particular has all the lights and all the dark. And I think, you know, when you get close to that deeper, deeper blue that's almost black, I think you get vulnerability. And I think that's where, even as when I think of him, I think that, you know, for someone to navigate these spaces at that time and trying to be fully who they were, they always had to navigate this vulnerable space of feeling not enough or someone's going to violate them or diminish them in some way. But everything about him was to wake back up in the morning and fuel himself every single day. And that fuel was, I think, a lot of blue.
There's something about the choice of blue, because I think most people, oh, yes, please do. Yes. I think many people think of red as the color of romance or love or lust, but actually I think that blue is a really beautiful romantic color because it's the color of water. It's the space where we're reborn. It's the space where we can float. If you're calm enough in water, you can move in with it. But if something goes wrong, the water moves a little bit more violently, a bit more fast. And I think that actually the color of love and romance is blue because it's so close to the thing that we are also made up of.
You know what, Cynthia, there's wild, it's wild because I just, as you're saying that, you made me think that I was like, oh, that's right. And he was a Pisces. Mm-hmm. So, I just discovered that. I was like, oh, that's right. March 17th, he was a Pisces. He was a water sign.
That's right.
So there we go.
Yeah, that's right.
Sometimes, you know, this beautiful thing that happens, I think even, I'm still in process, apparently, with this film. Mm-hmm. It hasn't ended at all, because even if I thought I did enough research and I thought enough inquiry and interrogation, there's new things that are coming as I'm discussing. Like even just a couple weeks ago, Gail King asked me, well, how old was Bayard when he organized the March on Washington? And I said, oh, wait, I thought I knew. I thought, what, late 40s? Because I think I just generally knew late 40s or, yeah. And because I felt like I knew everything else. And she says, oh, let's go back to the math. He was born in this 1970. He was 51 years old. How old were you when you started shooting? I was 51 years old.
Oh, my God.
Wow.
So that came later. The things that you don't know that you were, I think, and it's funny, the thing that I knew for sure, if I didn't know anything before I went on this journey, I knew that I had what I needed in me to attempt to do this work, you know?
Yeah. It reminds me of, we watched a documentary and the subject of the documentary said that art finds its way to whoever it's meant to find its way to when it's meant to find its way there. And when we listened to that, I think at first I thought the art we make will find its way to whoever is meant to view it. But actually, I think all art, so the art that we're meant to make will find its way to us as well. So I think you doing this piece, it was always meant. Mm-hmm. You were just waiting for it to find you, you know?
For years, you know, the people who keep Bayard's legacy in their heart because it's not taught in schools, they're out there. And for many years, in my 20s, 30s, 40s, someone every maybe 5 years would say, you know, when they do a biopic about Bayard Rustin, it has to be you. Yeah. I had another friend. You know what? Have you ever thought about writing something about Bayard Rustin? I was like, that seems like a lot of size. I don't know if I can handle that. They're like, you should, though. This went on for years.
Yeah.
And so finally, when this opportunity came about, I actually said for the first time, I'm not this person. I said, there's no one else who can play him. Mm-hmm. I have everything that I need. Mm-hmm. I was willing, you know?
You know what really struck me? You know, the end of the film is to see the words come up about the fact that he had this love in his life as well, and that he lived a very full life. And I think that is something, particularly when it comes to our queer heroes, queer Black heroes, they oftentimes die before they get a chance to really fulfill their greatest purpose. And their lives sometimes being sacrificed means we then have to carry on. And we're still carrying on. But what I really, it just sort of hit me, the fact that that's what I was left with. Like, it wasn't just the end. You told us, you know what? He got to live his life. And he did it not alone. And I think that, to me, is just very powerful. And I remember thinking, I wanted to ask you, how important was that for y'all to leave us with that fact?
Very much so. I think, as we know, that when there's usually stories about us in our existence, that they are suffering a tragedy in some way. Mm-hmm. And everything about this film, from the music choices, mm-hmm, to the color of light, mm-hmm, to there's a buoyancy. There's a tribute saying that, you know, of how we really live and how we really are, and how we contribute to the world. It's joyous, actually. It's joyously defiant, I think. And I think that that is sort of revolutionary. It's not a dusty history lesson. We don't leave his sex out of it. Mm-hmm. We make sure that it's very much a part of this film. Mm-hmm. I think that's a triumph. I think we show so many colors of a character and really living in spaces. I think that's revolutionary, to be honest. And he's not living in a silo. And he's not, you know, saying, oh, woe is me. He's like, okay, this is what you think? Let me get up and go again. And then to leave this, it does feel like a bit of grace to leave with that cry around about how he did find love and honoring that. And then he continued. He continued to work for, you know, LGBTQIA rights. He kept going. He was a man who gave his life to service for the betterment of all of us in this room. So, and I think that, I think it comes from the top down, from our executive producers, President Barack Obama and Michelle Obama, to honestly, there's so much love and respect and grace for not only the life of this fantastic man, but also all these other unsung people from the movement. You know, Ella Baker, A. Philip Randolph, you know, all these other people that, like, I think that it's beautiful that they leave them all on a high. One of my favorite lines is Dr. Anna Hedgman, when she says to Bayard at the end, he said, something her dad used to say, have you been useful today? I feel like there's so much about it at the end that carries us. The idea that at the end when he's picking up trash, that was honestly one of my favorite parts of the whole script. Because I thought, here's someone who's absolutely attached to doing good in the world, whether he gets the shine or not.
Right.
Yeah. And that is the most important thing. Mm. This is veering off for a second from the question, but we were talking about this just about, and when we were backstage, about that the idea of celebrity, people being attached to the celebrity and forgetting about the work. And it's the work that brought you here, and that should bring you much more joy. So for me, it's like the film is examining so much, and at the end of the day, it does feel like it's been made, not only, like I say, from the top to the bottom, with love, but it really is about love and the idea that there's love for this man, and there's love in the world for him. If that isn't actionable and given to an audience saying, hey, we're not tragic figures. We're figures with fire and fuel and love and service and joy, and we can be messy at the same time. But take it all.
That's sexy, too.
Yes, yes. Yes, yes. A question I always get asked about the characters I play, and I always love it because it makes me think, and I wonder if you've been asked the same question. What did Bayard teach you about yourself?
I can answer that pretty clearly.
Uh-huh.
He taught me that I was a leader. Mm-hmm. And I kind of always knew, but I sort of was doing it in a very sort of side hustle way.
Mm-hmm.
For all my theater kids out there. Yeah, that's it. For my theater kids, you know, on the first day of rehearsal, you know, when Actors Equity, all the equity mm-hmm. folks are in the room,
mm-hmm.
and they say, well, okay, we're going to choose an equity deputy.
And everybody does this.
And people usually duck. And they're like, oh, I don't want to be a deputy. I don't want to have to deal with that. And usually, 9 times out of 10, someone says, I nominate Colman. And then for years, I was like, okay, I'll do it. You know, it's the go-between yourself and producers, make sure things are right and mm-hmm. things are done. And done in a very diplomatic way. Mm-hmm. And then for years, it was like, okay, after a while, I was like, okay, how about I'm gonna nominate myself? Because apparently I'm the one to do it. I've always been the equity deputy. I've always felt like I know how to make things happen mm-hmm. and do it in a way that that is done in a heartful and thoughtful way, but with a lot of, you know, rigor and work ethic. And on this film in particular, I stepped into a whole new, brand new pair of shoes, not only to be in almost every frame of this film, but to actually know that I was going to be the soul of the production. And I say, well, this is the way we do it. Mm-hmm. We make sure that everyone knows the task, that you're in service. Mm-hmm. Every single person came in, every and I think it was new for everyone, every bit of transpo and grip and everything. I'm like, no, this is a march. Mm-hmm. And if I'm here 14 hours a day with as much love and grace and interrogation and rigor and work ethic, so are you. When you come in for any, you come in for 2 days of work, you're jumping on board this ship. We're gonna make something special that is about honoring these people who did so much for us. And we want to give everything we have, and we're gonna do it with love and joy. And I would break out into song, and we sing We Shall Overcome, or we sing This Little Light of Mine. It didn't matter. But we would have a good time, because that's also what they did too. They didn't just march. They had a good time. That's the thing that I learned. They did it joyously and with dance and music and love. And I knew I can lead that way. So I knew that, like, I knew I had that Bayard in me.
Yeah.
And he taught me that. And he said, no, go forth with that and be full with that. Mm. And to stand in rooms and sort of own my power, like Bayard has. Bayard always owned his power in rooms that were not set up for him. And I think I stand a little taller, and I walk in. I'll tell you this, because I just thought about this. When I did this show years ago on Broadway, it was my first Broadway show, called Passing Strange.
Yeah. Come on, don't just throw it out like that.
Just deep cuts. That's come my on. Friend. Deep cuts, but I remember walking in with, I was just so like walking in, and I walked in, I opened the door wide, and I walked in, and I don't know what I was giving off, but one of my castmates sort of laughed at me. He's like, what's all that? I said, what's all what? And he was like, that was a lot, the way you walked in. And then I took it in, and I got smaller. Mm. And I started to like feel like I was doing too much, and I was being too much, because I was proud. I'm like, I come from inner city West Philadelphia. There was nothing in my life that said that I could be here. Mm. You know? When I look at it now, I was owning that space and feeling like, this is not only me walking in, I'm walking in with ancestors. You know what I mean? That we did something. And so I had to find that again and say, no, I can't let that person dim me down. That was making them feel better. And so I feel like that's what I learned stepping into Bayard. And Bayard always stood in and said, okay, whatever way you look at me is the way you're going to look at me. Mm-hmm. But I have nothing to do with that. All I can do is be in my fullness. Mm-hmm. And I know right now, what a beautiful journey in that way to be where I am now. And I really do feel like walking in fully who I am without apology.
I think I'm gonna switch up my last question, because I think that kind of spoke to it. As we come to a close, I think this question hopefully is something that people can walk away with something, and that we look at these period pieces, even calling them that, they're period pieces, because it was a different period in our history, in our country, in our society. But it's hard to look at this film and not feel as though we are at the same crossroads. Mm. So how does it feel for you to be at the center of this film that is talking about our past, but yet it's saying so much about our present? So what is that bridge between Rustin and today?
I think, first of all, this film was supposed to come out last year. And we got held up because of some COVID delays and couldn't get onto the Washington Mall to finish it up. And it was divine, I think. Mm. Because I think we need this film now more than ever. As legislation is trying to turn us back to 1963.
Come on.
We have a film that is inspiring people to say, no. Get involved. Mm-hmm. Don't feel disheartened. Get energized. Form coalitions. Mm-hmm. You know, with people you may not think you have anything in common with, but actually you do. We have to come together. This because the world is falling apart, mm-hmm, in every single way, and we don't even know how to talk to each other. Mm-hmm. especially in these moments where we are right now, we're looking, how these people were in a room together. You see that fiery scene with me and Jeffrey Wright and everyone else around. But they didn't leave. They didn't leave the room. They stayed in the room, and with all these people with different ideologies and just of ways to get things done. But at the center was trying to move the needle for everyone. But everyone had to get involved in some way. So I think that what I think is so useful about a film like this today, I really hope that it inspires young people in particular to know that the people who organized this march were 19 and 20 years old.
Say that.
You know, that they took part of their democracy and saying, we're going to make this happen. I think that that's what's actionable right now. And to see, I think it's also revolutionary to see a central character like Bayard Rustin in his fullness. Mm. So you can't deny his humanity, you know? And so I think that they can examine us of being participants in this world and making a difference. It's a movie that was made in every single way to feel like it's actionable for now.
Yes.
It wasn't intended to be a history piece. It was to look at this human and this slice of life, and how can we stir and rouse us up today? Because we need it more than ever. And I truly, first of all, just thank you so much for today. And thank you for coming.
Thank you.